Megalodon is extinct. Well, actually, 90% of the ocean is still unexplored. Who knows what lurks at the deepest? Megalodon is most likely extinct. This video isn't really about the if, though. I already made two videos about that. Rather, this video is about the how and the why. How could an apex predator the size of a railroad car go extinct? Well, not too surprisingly, with topics like this, there are always multiple theories. Some think that it was space that killed the beast. Well, not exactly, but some astrophysicists think that a supernova, or a chain of supernovas, could have killed off the Meg. A study published in the Journal of Astrobiology in November 2018 talked about ancient seabed deposits of iron-60 isotopes. As the lead author of the study, Adrian Mellett, said, iron-60 is radioactive. If it was formed with the Earth, it would be long gone by now, and there's no other way for it to get to Earth but from a supernova. Looking at the iron-60 residue, they found a huge spike 2.6 million years ago. The supernova, or series of supernovas, showered Earth with muons. What are muons? Well, according to Mellett, the best description of a muon would be a very heavy electron, 100 times more massive than an electron. They're very penetrating. There are lots of them passing through us. Nearly all of them pass through harmlessly. But when this wave of cosmic rays hits, multiply those muons by a few hundred. You get increased mutations and cancer. These would be the main biological effects. They estimate that for an animal the size of a human, the cancer rate would go up by about 50%. But the bigger you are, the worse it is. For animals closer in size to an elephant, whale, or megalodon, the radiation dose goes up a lot more. The researchers said that the damage from muons would extend down hundreds of meters, but would become less severe at greater depths. So, Megs swimming deeper down might have had more protection from the muons, but there's actually a bigger problem with the supernova theory, at least as an explanation for the Meg's demise. So we used to think the Meg went extinct about 2.6 million years ago, and this would line up with the supernova event, but that date might not be very accurate. In 2019, a paleontologist named Robert Bosnaker, as well as some of his colleagues, published a new study where they revisited various fossils of Megalodon. After looking over many, many fossils, they found something interesting. All the fossils dated as younger than 3.6 million years had some issues. They had imprecise dates, they had been misidentified, or the dating has since improved and been refined. Since no megalodon fossil could be dated younger than 3.6 million years, this pushes the extinction of megalodon back by about a million years. As Robert said, we found that the extinction of O. megalodon must have happened at least 1 million years earlier than previously determined. So if the supernovas didn't wipe them out, then there must be another reason why the megalodon is megalogon. Well, megalodon had to eat a lot of food. Based on its body size, it's estimated that an adult megalodon would need to eat about 2,500 pounds of food, that's 1,134 kilos, every day. This was mostly large marine mammals, including baleen whales, dolphins, sea lions, dugongs, and it also ate fish and sea turtles. The megalodon had to constantly feed, which would make it particularly vulnerable when its prey dropped in number or migrated to cooler waters. Not only do we think this was happening at the time, but we also think the Meg had to deal with more competition. As the saying goes, there's always a bigger fish. Except by fish, I mean mammal, and by bigger, I mean about the same size. I'm talking, of course, about the macroraptorial sperm whales, one of the largest being the Leviathan Melville, named after the biblical sea monster and the author of Moby Dick, Herman Melville. It was roughly about the same size as Megalodon, and it too liked to eat baleen whales. Probably being another apex predator in its ecosystem, it likely would have competed with the Megalodon for food. It was also during this time period that we see the emergence of the orca, which also would have hunted some similar prey, and maybe even juvenile megalodons. And there is yet another suspect. Let's go back to the Robert Bosnaker-led study about gauging when the Meg went extinct. The new dates of the Meg extinction coincide with the rise and spread of the great white shark. Of course, the great white shark is much smaller than a megalodon, but it could have competed with juvenile megs. with the great whites feeding on prey that juvenile Megalodon also preyed on, and these smaller Megs would have had to have eaten a lot more food to get bigger. University of Maryland's Breton Kent also suggests that perhaps the tiger shark put stress on the juvenile Megalodon populations, but he is also not convinced that competition between species could lead to such a decline. Difficult to put together a perfect picture of how the extinction happened, but there are certainly some promising ideas. Perhaps it was a combination of multiple or all the factors that drove them to extinction. Though the muon spike happened 2.6 million years ago, there were lesser amounts hitting the Earth for millions of years before that. Add in a changing climate with less food and more competition for that depleting food, and we see that being a very big shark doesn't really help. In fact, it's kind of a hindrance. There is a quote often attributed to Darwin that I'm sure you've heard, "survival of the fittest," but this quote is actually from Herbert Spencer, a sociologist and philosopher. What Darwin actually said was, "It's not the strongest of the species that survives, nor the most intelligent, but the most responsive to change." No, Darwin never said that either. That is a quote from Leon C. Meganson, a business professor from Louisiana State University. I guess he misquoted Darwin? Okay, what did Darwin actually say? Well, plot twist, in later versions of On the Origin of Species, if we search for the term survival, Darwin said, "I have called this principle, by which each slight variation, if useful, is preserved, by the term natural selection." But the expression used by Herbert Spencer of the survival of the fittest is more accurate and is sometimes equally convenient. He mentions the term survival of the fittest 15 times, so I guess he did like this term, even if he didn't originally coin it. Anyway, all of this was just a roundabout way to say that Megalodon, being a gigantic shark, didn't really make it fit for its environment, unlike some of its smaller, surviving relatives. Thanks for watching.